Hi, everyone, and welcome to our session two on eradicating racism. This session is brought to you by Cottage Media, Hotelier Magazine, and the Easton's Group. My name is Rita Gupta, and I'm so happy and so proud to see all of you here today to come together to join our conversation to put an end to racism. Last year, as the world fought a global silent war, there was another war that we've been fighting for hundreds of years that really came about and really was so loud, and that was the fight on racism. And when this happened, it really impacted my heart. Being Indian, being a woman, I've seen so much racism growing up in Canada. I've had people call me Apache to my face. I've had people tell me they don't want to work with an Indian, and they'll say it with conviction and a straight face. And it takes a lot to be able to get through that. And now, as we see yesterday, we're starting to see that change. We're starting to see a change in government. And I have to admit that when I saw Biden's speech yesterday, and he said, 108 years ago today, women were here marching for the right to vote, and look at where we are. And I thought, it took about 108 years to get an Indian Black woman as vice president. That is too long. I want to live in a world where it is normal for a woman to be in politics. I want to live in a world where it is normal for a woman of color to be in a position of power. And it is not something that we have to celebrate. This needs to be normal. And this is why we are all here today, so we can talk about this, so we can put an end to this, so we can start building that awareness. And that is what we are going to do today. It is my absolute pleasure to introduce Ms. Rosanna Kaira, who's the editor and publisher of Cottage Media. She is the queen of the hotel industry. And let me tell you, last year, I wrote a letter and I asked everyone to stand with me so hotels and hospitality can unite in peace. And she was the first one to email me and say, okay, Ritu, what can we do? And here we are today. She has always been an advocate for women. She's been an advocate for racism and to stop racism, and I just adore her. So Rosanna Kaira, over to you.
Well, thank you so much, Ritu. First of all, for being a partner on this important initiative, for being a sponsor, and also for being you, because you are wonderful and you really have such passion for the hospitality industry. So I'm really touched that you're able to do this with us. Your support, dedication, and enthusiasm are really heartwarming and very appreciated. So good morning, everyone. And thank you for being here today to take part in our Eradicating Racism Part 2. Many of you may remember that last year on August 11th, which seems like a lifetime ago now, amidst a pandemic that knocked the world off its feet, KML and Easton's co-hosted a two-hour discussion with 12 industry leaders to look at what discrimination looks like in this industry, and as well to examine the type of barriers that exist that really prevent true diversity and equality. We also examined how these barriers could be eradicated to ensure that employees are treated justly and without discrimination. Now, 5 months later, as we promised last summer, we're back to assess what companies are actually doing to move the dial on discrimination and how we as an industry can move forward. We have a smaller group of industry leaders with us today, pulled from that original roundtable, and together we're going to try to keep this conversation moving forward. Our objectives today are twofold. We'd like to spend the first half hour assessing what companies in this industry have been doing since our first meeting last August. And then we also want to hear from each panelist about their specific company initiatives. Then in the second half of the hour, we would like to offer up some solutions and provide some direction as to what needs to be done as an industry to continue to make progress on this front, touching on creating a wish list of sorts from the hospitality industry of what can be incorporated into these frameworks. We know that eradicating racism is an ambitious undertaking, and we're not naive to believe this will happen overnight. But we need to begin this journey. To date, various groups have stepped up to come up with structural frameworks for this work. As an example, Black North and the federal government's 50-30 initiative are only two examples. Additionally, some companies such as Marriott, Accor, Gusto 54, as well as Hilton, whose representative Vito Corrali could not be here with us today, have already done some very important work on this front, and they're happy to share what has been accomplished so far. During our first committee meeting earlier this year, we had discussed what kind of framework we wanted to move forward And the committee felt that rather than creating a charter pledge, it would make more sense and be more efficient to take the groundwork that's already been established by so many others, including the companies I mentioned earlier, and build on it to create a commitment framework that could then be used by any interested company in the industry as a jumping board to create their own mandates, guidelines, and directions. Once we finalize this commitment framework with more input from the industry, we're happy to share that through the industry networks. We will leave some time today at the end of our discussion for some questions from our audience. So if you have anything during our discussion, please feel free to jot that down and we'll be sure to answer as many as possible. Now, without further ado, let me introduce you to our panel. First off, to our right or to my right, Michelle Kane, Chair of the Hospitality Management Program at Centennial College. Christina Vera, GM, Bar Mordecai, an industry educator. Don Cleary, President of Marriott Hotels of Canada. Sarah Glenn, Senior Vice President, Accor North America and the Caribbean. Juanita Dixon, President of Gusto 54 Restaurant Group. And last but not least, Ritu Gupta, President and CEO of Easton's Hotels and our partner and sponsor on today's webcast. So good morning, everybody, and a big welcome and thank you for being here today, to taking time out of your busy schedules to join us. So as I mentioned earlier in my introduction, I thought we could start off by just setting the stage for what has been done at your specific companies over the last 6 months since our first webcast. Some of that work may have actually started much earlier than that, but I thought we could start our discussion today with that. So Michelle, why don't I start with you today and tell us a little bit about what's been done at Centennial College.
Thank you, Rosanna. And good morning, everyone. For me, as Chair of Hospitality Management at Centennial College, it's actually, I wouldn't say easy, but a little bit more approachable, because Centennial was part of, whether it's anti-Black racism or anti any type of racism or injustice, was already ahead of the game. And so before 2020, Centennial had already established a Center for Global Citizenship, Education and Inclusion. Being an international college, it really was part of our fabric, of our DNA. We have almost 100 ethno-cultural groups represented on our campus, 80 languages spoken. We respect, and I've already highlighted, diverse race, sex, ancestry, sexual orientation, gender identity, age, and ability. So 2020 wasn't, and I don't mean to speak for the whole college, but definitely wasn't a surprise. And it did encourage, it did show a magnifying glass in some areas, and we still have a lot of room to improve. But being an international college, having respect and appreciation for human beings, and the number of individuals that work there from diverse backgrounds. When I walked into my role almost 7 years ago, my predecessor was a Black female who had been a leader in the hospitality industry prior to me arriving there. So I already give credit to Farona Barkley, who was a stable in hospitality in Toronto. So I was grateful for that. When I left the industry, food and beverage, and walked into the college, I was welcomed with smiling Black faces, brown faces, Asian faces, with women and men with disabilities that were very obvious, and those that weren't. So that was already there. So I'm grateful to say that. But like I said, there are some rooms for improvement. Before 2020 and 2019, Centennial College launched a Black Mentorship Initiative, which I was very grateful to be a part of. And there were some questions, and there have been some questions, about having a specific Black Mentorship Initiative versus a mentorship initiative. This year, or sorry, 2020, we also launched a Women's Mentorship Initiative. A few years ago, if you had asked me, do we need two, I would have said, no, we can have one. But really, in my own skin and with my own experiences, I see the opportunity to have a Black Mentorship Initiative when it comes to Black students, Black colleagues, and the community. So I'm grateful for that. We also, post 2020, or so I should say, post Black Lives Matter, we have launched, our president has led the launch of the Anti-Black Racism Task Force. And again, I'm blessed to be a part of that as well. that is led by our executive team, including our president, Dr. Craig Stevenson, as well as the director of the Center for Global Citizenship, Education, and Inclusion, Yasmin Razik. So it wasn't unusual for us to put together this task force. It wasn't another email that came across the organization that thought, why are we doing this? It was pretty clear. I think some people thought, what took Centennial so long? We should have already been doing this. We should have already had an anti-Black racism task force because it's something that we do. When we first joined, we had our first meeting in November, and any of the Black colleagues that I ever knew that existed at Centennial College were all on the same call, but also our allies, including our non-Black colleagues, including our president and vice president. And that was encouraging. And already there were some uncomfortable conversations. There were some uncomfortable comments that we have professors, we have students, and we have community members, and some people saying, are we doing this because it's 2020, or are we doing this because it's the right thing to do? So our first meeting was positive, and we have additional meetings coming forth. We also have working groups, and the working group that I'm a part of is human resources. And human resources, we're talking about not just our student race, but also our employers and our leaders and what we can do, what we can do better. When you walk into the college, it looks very diverse. When you walk into our faculty meetings, it looks diverse enough. When you walk into our management meetings, it starts to not look as diverse. And when you walk into the executive table, it's not very diverse at all. So again, we do have some opportunities, including our own board of governors, who right now our board of governor chair is a Black female, which we're very proud of, but again, more work to be done. So what has Centennial College been doing since our last meeting? The same that it has been doing in the past, maybe with a little bit more vigor, a little bit more acceleration, and with more honesty and open door where people can come in and say, okay, but here are some more things we can do. So as an employee of Centennial College, feel that we're on the right track. Again, I can't speak for the whole organization, but I can definitely feel that the sincerity, the opportunity, and the commitment from the community as well as the executive leadership.
Well, that's amazing. Thank you. And the Black Mentorship Initiative sounds really interesting. So I'll be really interested to know how that goes for you in the next little while, Michelle. So we'll have regular updates. Christina, how about from your perspective? I know you're working in the independent restaurant space, but you're also a hospitality educator. So you're hearing from a lot of other people in the industry. What do you think, what have you done or seen in your establishment and perhaps some other establishments over the last 6 months?
Yeah, so our place, Bar Mordecai, is relatively small, especially considering the panel. So on a pure representation checklist, we kind of check a lot of boxes. I'm there. One of the owners is Indigenous. The kitchen team are both Asian. The other owner is a white woman. So in general, we're like, if you're doing everything from a do we have these demographics sorted? We're doing pretty well. So for us especially, but just in general, it's not so much only about having the representation, but like really analyzing how we're aligning and how we're holding other partners and who we're aligning with. And that has been, especially in a lockdown where we're not going to necessarily be doing a hiring spree, is like really analyzing like what people are getting and what we're putting out there. So that's a variety of things. It's I do a lot of partnerships with brands, especially with liquor brands in our initiatives. And often that means that we will use other businesses as well. Maybe it's pairing with like a skincare line in our online shops. And we as a company have become incredibly in tune with not only what we are doing, but who we are recommending. Not only local, but in terms of the demographic that they're owned by, not as much allowing many of these companies that have incredibly like white power structures also are very likely to recommend other businesses that they're just used to. So just really very much having that. And it really works from a neighborhood perspective as well. And generally speaking, people like to know that you as a small business are also not necessarily just going to like the easiest thing to find, but finding other vendors that are in the same boat. So that's been a pretty big thing from our perspective and really analyzing our suppliers and who we have strategic partnerships with, and also just helping our partners create other relationships like that as well and modeling that for other people, because it's really easy when you're small to just get into this mindset that like any 10 cents I can save is 10 cents. But also when you're say aligning with a shop down the road that has a different demographic than you're used to, you're actually more likely in this current state of our economy to expand what your sales are, because we are now also much more neighborhood focused as a restaurant than before, where people are easily driving in for a night out. In terms of me as an educator and in terms of other consulting work that I do, there's been a few different changes. One is I'm personally going through the steps of creating my own school that would offer the WSET certifications that I teach. And I teach pre-COVID, I taught here and in the States, especially online. That's really helped that. And I think it's significant for a few reasons. There's over, I think, 900 schools that offer WSET certifications globally, and only one, arguably two, we have a back and forth, are owned by a Black person. It's in 70 countries, and represents over 15 languages. That is, it's drastically small. Even in the Asian schools, many of them are owned by white people. So increasing the representation of POC in education is also pretty significant. And it increases if it's a sales staff or if it's your executive, what they're used to seeing as experts. It also changes how different topics are taught, which I think is a major thing. I know that Michelle can expand on that too, but who is teaching and what perspective they're coming from can also help tear down what people expect as an expert and who they expect to look to and who they see as an authority figure.
That's a very important point, very well said, Christina, and so exciting that you're doing your own school on that end. So congratulations.
Yeah.
Good luck with that. Sarah, from your perspective at Accor Hotels, I know you're a larger company, so you have probably a few different kinds of resources that you can tap into, but what has been going on there for over the last 6 months?
Well, I think kind of harken back to what Michelle said with Centennial. You know, you're a large organization, diversity and inclusivity is core to our values. But when you start to kind of refocus your lens and focus in on what you are doing and what you aren't doing, you realize that yes, you have programs and policies in place, but there are gaps as well. And so to really get under it, we took we looked at it across the organization, vertically through the business as well. And in terms of across the organization, what we did is partnered with Kern Ferry to use their expertise in diversity and inclusivity to listen to the hotels and really to get the feedback from the field as to what do they see as opportunities, what do they see as weaknesses, what are we doing and what aren't we doing? Where are the gaps? And that, to be honest, brought us some candid, some difficult conversations, candid input, difficult conversations, but good feedback. I mean, at the end of the day, feedback is a gift. And I think it is real and meaningful information. And that is helping to fuel, well, where do we need to change? How do we need to adapt? And what do we need to do? In addition, we deployed unconscious bias training across both the NCA team, but also across the field teams, because I think understanding where your biases are that you're completely unaware of, and I know that for many, it was very enlightening, and myself included, you just don't realize that in your choice of words, in your choice of actions, or whatever, what it could denote to somebody else that when you have different filters, right? And then, you know, if we look through the kind of the vertical stack of the business model, we're also looking for opportunities, whether it is in recruiting and how we are bringing people into the organization, where we're recruiting, how we're doing it, but also with the supplier relationships, you know, where we're spending our money and what groups are we spending our money with? And do we have, you know, kind of diversity across that? So we're looking at kind of all of those areas and really working with groups like Korn Ferry, and we'll talk about the Black North Initiative in a little bit, and NABHOOD in the States, other groups and making sure that we've got a sharing of information and ideas.
So Sarah, when you talk about unconscious bias, are you asking all of your team to go through that kind of training, or is it done in certain areas only? How are you doing that?
No, the whole, all of the NCA team went through it and all of the leadership team went through it.
Okay, great. Well, thank you for sharing. Dawn, similarly at Marriott, obviously you're a huge company and you've got some frameworks in place, but what has been done over the last 5 to 6 months there to really cement this journey?
Sure. Well, similar to, I think, what Sarah said about Accor, obviously Marriott has a long, deep commitment to diversity and inclusion. And I think I shared in the earlier podcast that we had with this group, a lot of our efforts that are designed towards the hiring and promoting, developing and welcoming and making, building community with all our people of color and all of our diverse population. So unbiased training has been something we've been doing for years. But with the events, starting with the George Foster killing and the sort of the a huge eruption of the Black Lives Matter, I think our company really set back and reflected on what we were doing. And as proud as we are of our history and many of the things we've been doing, I think we realized that there was probably a lot more that we as a company and that society in general can do to advance this cause. So I've candidly seen more focus on this issue since George Floyd than in my 30 years with the company. It has become a big priority. And I'll name just a few of the things that have been going on. First of all, as I mentioned when we were together in August, you know, we created a board committee on this, you know, decades ago, that has been sort of at the senior leadership level of our company, driving a lot of our policies. We've gone in and renamed, repurposed, and refocused that board committee. It's now called the Global Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Committee. We've created four subcommittees, one of which alone is focused on diversity, inclusion, and promoting people of minority groups or different subsets. Again, around the world, you define that differently. We've created a new Global and Diversity Council that is chaired, the folks that sit on that are the presidents from around the globe. I represent Canada on that as the president of Canada. And then each continent has formed their own subset. So we have a diversity one for the US and Canada. And each of those have set their performance metrics and priorities. And I can say the one in North America is focused on the recruitment, development and training and promotion of our people of color. That is the focus on the US one. A couple of other things we've done besides what we've done in revamping at the most senior level are diversity inclusion councils that are really driving a multitude of other events that we're doing. I will share one good news. For instance, at the North American leadership level, we have about a dozen people that sit on the US and Canada Senior Leadership Committee. We've had three African Americans promoted since we were last together on positions on that leadership council. Our head of our global office, our officer of sales and marketing for all of US and Canada was a Black man that was just recently appointed. And then our head of operations globally that also sits on the US and Canada leadership team was promoted to the global role. And our we promoted a new president of franchising and management of our select service brands is also a Black American. So that's been great, right immediately in our leadership team. But I think the one area that has been, for me, I think most impactful, and I've enjoyed it, is that we have Arnie Sorensen, our CEO, and David Rodriguez, our head of HR, launched a series of what they call community talks that are open to virtually everybody in the company. They are webinars where they lead them, bring other senior executives, and really talk about the issue of racism specifically. And they've now had, I believe, three of those. And this is where we open up to feedback from people from all levels of the company. Again, I think we've started this dialogue. Again, I think similar to what Sarah said at Accor, some stuff has been hard to hear, but it helps us formulate our policies and direction. I know one of those I participated in, we had a couple of our most senior Black executives in the company participate in those and tell their own stories. And these are people that are very senior in our company. And to hear them talk about incidents of racism that they've experienced on their climb up through Marriott or that they experience in broader society today demonstrates how much work we still all have to do in this space. Those continue to occur. We also have smaller cadres of associates coming out of our hotels. This was something we called our talent network teams, which were small groups of associates that were willing to take on issues to really talk at the grassroots level about what we can do to improve our business. They've been around for years, but this year we've launched new ones that are focused specifically on addressing racism and what more we can do to create a more inclusive and welcoming environment across our company. And so those are being launched. And then I guess the last thing I'd add, in addition to many other initiatives that that are coming out of our councils and setting tangible targets for how many we wanna advance into senior management positions. The last thing I've done is in Canada, we did sign on as an early adopter company on the Canada, 50-30 initiative, which the government just launched in mid-December. That was just launched and we did work through with them and have signed on to be a part of that. And what that means, and I think we'll talk about this later, as you mentioned, Rosanna, but it's a company's commitment to get to 50% women and 30% people of color at your leadership ranks within the company. And that is something that we've signed on to establish as our goals for our team in Canada. So that's a few of the things we're up to.
Well, thank you for sharing. It sounds like there's a lot of continuing dialogue there and there's some good movement in terms of numbers on the executive side. So that's good to hear. Juanita, I know from your perspective, you've done some work at Gusto 54 and putting through a mandate and some direction. Can you speak a little bit about what you've done at your company? Juanita?
Yeah, absolutely. Good morning, everyone.
I wanted to make sure you heard me.
Yep. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Yeah, no, there's technology. It works when it works and when it doesn't, mamma mia. Yeah. Thank you for having me here today. Being a women-led organization, I think Gusto 54 has prided itself in really being an equal opportunity employer and creating a workforce that's grounded in respect and free of discrimination. But I think our path has been similar to Dawn's story and Sarah's story in that this past summer, when we made a revised commitment to really eradicating racism, that priority became escalated. And we realized where we always come and say, we are a supporter of this, we opened the lines of communication to our team members. And at the time, we had just recently laid off almost 700 employees, but we included those furloughed employees as part of the conversation to really take the time to listen and to say, what else can we be doing as an organization to actively be part of the solution and the change that's needed, not only in our company, but in the industry as a whole. And so our process started by really creating this manifesto and creating a platform and an opportunity for people across the organization to be become involved and really have their voice heard. So we created this infrastructure, this committee, that we're calling Anti-Racism, Equity, and Inclusion. And it was a blind process where we invited and chose two people per restaurant. So we have 9 restaurants in Toronto and 1 in California. And it was an interesting process because it was at the point in time where we were just operating at probably 20% capacity because of COVID. And so we did open the lines up to all of our employees from where we were prior to March. And it was really heartening to see how many people actually raised their hands and volunteered to say, I want to be part of this. I want to be part of the conversation. So this committee met, initially it was going to meet once a month, but it ended up, because there was so much conversation and so much discussion, we ended up doing every 2 weeks. And we looked at really aligning, getting the feedback from these two representatives per restaurant on what our manifesto is and what our commitment is in this movement and how we're going to make a change. And then the mandate of this committee was divided into 6 different categories. The accountability of how are we going to hold ourselves accountable as an organization? Do we need targets? Do we need mandate? What is all of our mandates? What are look at all of them, the hiring practices and training and development in HR and all of those things to really identify where are we going to move the needle? What are we doing well right now? Where can we actually be doing a better job? We took a look at, we did an analysis or an audit of all of our policies, all of our HR practices, all of our hiring awesome program, and did a deep dive to say, okay, we thought we were doing a good job on this. Where can we actually improve? And with the feedback from the committee and this diverse approach to getting everyone's opinions on where can we actually move the needle on this, there in some cases there was no change, but in some cases there it was around revising the language and having an escalated approach and discussion and conversation around how we can make a difference. And I think this notion of the policies, the conversation, the training and development is probably the biggest area that we will be focusing on this year once we get back out of COVID and bring back 90% of our workforce. But it's really centered around this notion of being part of the conversation and the training and development and creating a series of webinars and opportunities to have these discussions around unconscious bias, around bystander intervention, around hearing people's stories so that we have a better perspective of diversity and how everyone is coming to the table, how to be an ally. And those were the top 3 conversations that came out that we thought as a culture, we could all benefit from having a better perspective and really understanding where everyone is coming from. And then really even taking a look at not only how can we make that change within our own culture and within our own 4 walls and our 9 different concepts, but then how do we actually share that with the industry? Can we be making a difference in giving away some of this content and all of these, we have online training tools and things that we are in the process of launching out that we could actually really share and with the rest of the industry who may not have the assets or the resources to develop this type of a content. So that was a big part of it. And then also looking at community-wise, how can really taking a look at our Gusto Gives Back program, which has historically been centered around poverty-related issues and making sure that food is in the right mouths, and it was really food focused. And we took a step back and took a look at, are there other areas that we should be focusing our financial resources? And, you know, in June, we collected $1 per takeout order contribute to there were three or four different groups that we were contributing to at the time: Black Legal Action Center, the Black Health Alliance, and Urban Alliance were the three that we're looking at. But we're continuing to take a look at what organizations are actually now 6 months later having the biggest impact in moving the needle. And those are the organizations that we are continuing to support and really embracing. And I think as an industry wide, really making sure that we're not reinventing the wheel, but capitalizing on all of the things that we're doing as a group to make a difference.
Well, that's great. Sounds like you've done a lot of work, and it's great that you're able to share that. I know you sent that to some of the committee members, and you've done a lot of work there. So hopefully we can work together to add to that. Ritu, how about from your perspective at Easton's, what have the last 6 months looked like for you?
Sure, I'll try to keep this concise, because I know we also have a lot of audience questions that we want to get to. So in 2019, November, we launched our Diversity and Inclusion Committee. We called it DICE, and I thought it was cute. The reason why we called it DICE, it was based on a saying, and that saying is, fortune confounds the wise, and when they least expect it, turns the dice. So our whole goal was that, you know, we now want to change the odds, and we want to turn the dice. We have a couple of different goals. So our goals include, you know, getting rid of bias, including more training. Also, as something Christina said as well, is making sure that who we're partnered with also aligns with our goals, because I feel like that's also as important as having diversity in your team. And our mandate is around, not only around having diversity, because we're not here to just fill statistics, but we also want to make sure the reason why we want diversity is diversity in thought. The reason why we want diversity is to make sure that everybody feels included, that everybody feels loved, everybody feels respect. For me, we can fill these stats, which is great, but if there's no respect, then we failed. And then we did not do a good job. So we started this back in November. And last week I had asked all of our DMs to submit to our head of HR and I, what are their stats? I want to know what our teams look like. What does it look like male versus female? What does it look like ethnically? And I was so happy, Rosetta, I shared these results with you this morning. 95% of our hotels, so basically all of our hotels but one, had over 50% females in supervisor positions, which was awesome. And Don, just so you know, the one hotel was not Marriott, just a side note. And in terms of ethnic teams, we had 85% of our teams, which were diverse. So three-pointer, for instance. However, joking aside, to me, stats are amazing. However, now we have to work on diversity of thought, and we have all this in place, which is great, but now we need to work on the commitment to this and make sure that the training is in place and that we continue pushing the envelope and pushing the needle, as everyone here has said.
Wonderful. Well, I know that the work is ongoing, and it's not something you do in a month and then forget about it. It's evolving and it's changing all the time. So it sounds like everybody's doing quite a lot on that front. And we will talk a little bit more about that in the rest of the webinar. But I know too, in my position as editor, I do see some information coming through from other companies. And I did want to share too that last December, Nestle Canada announced a partnership with the CEE Center for Young Black Professionals. It's a community-based organization that is really dedicated to addressing economic and social barriers affecting Black youth from the ages of 18 to 29. Nestle is going to be financially supporting the Kitchen Masters program and introducing Young Culinary Talent program for Black youth in Toronto's investment neighborhood. So that was another initiative that happened, you know, after our discussion in August, but obviously this is ongoing. And I know Starbucks has also committed to taking various steps to advance racial and social equality as part of its journey to create a more welcoming and inclusive environment. And basically what they're doing is they've created a mentorship program connecting BIPOC employees to senior leaders and investing in strategic partnerships with professional organizations that focus on BIPOC talent. They're also setting some annual tracking and inclusion goals of trying to target at least 30% of all corporate levels and at least 40% of all retail and manufacturing roles by 2025. So those are just two other examples of companies that are doing something in the hospitality space, which is interesting, and I thought I'd share that. So right now I wanted to also move to the next section of our discussion. And we talked a little bit about frameworks. You know, Gusto has a framework that they're working with, as do most of the companies represented here. I know, Don, we talked a little bit about the 50-30 initiative, which was introduced by the federal government last December. And I know you mentioned that Marriott has signed on. I had looked at the list of people or companies that have signed on to that initiative recently, and I hadn't seen very many hospitality companies. So I'm glad to hear that Marriott has signed on. Did you want to speak about that program briefly, just to tell us what some of the goals are and what your expectation is from this? Oh, you're muted, Don.
Thank you. Sorry. You think after a year we'd figure out how to fix that?
But you think?
I learned of it when I was called by Minister Baines and asked if we would participate. And that was the first I learned of it. So we took some time to understand what it is and quickly realized that it was very much aligned with what our corporate objectives are on where we want to get over the next few years in terms of the number of women in senior leadership positions at our Marriott's most senior level. As well as people of color. So it seemed very compatible with our corporate goals. We wanted to reflect on it in Canada and make sure it was consistent. You know, how do we define people of color in Canada? Things like that. But I more importantly, I saw it as a vehicle for us to share best practices that we learn that are being done in other companies. Share some of the practices that we're doing. I'll give you another example of one of the changes we've recently made. We just came out with a new mandatory policy that for all RFPs we do, including that all of our hotels, for all suppliers of everything, we have to have a diverse company, a company that is either a majority owned and operated by either women or people of color, are mandated to be one of the bidders. It's things like that. I know, for instance, in the US, the American Hotel and Lodging Association has formed a diversity and inclusion committee that's really designed for all of the major brands that are on that and major hotel companies to share best practices that, that they're doing. And I want to build it, and we have a representative on that, and I want to take the learnings from that and bring them to Canada and share them through this 50-30 initiative. I listen to what those on this call say they're doing, and I hear best practices that I think we can all learn from. So from my perspective, I view the 50-30 initiative, sponsored by the government of Canada, which is important, but it's broader than just hospitality. I think we can learn from other companies and build upon it and continue to leverage those resources.
And I think what's interesting about that framework is that, they're calling for significant representation, the 30% of senior management, but also of underrepresented groups that include not just racialized people, but people living with disabilities, for example, members of the LGBTQ to community. So I think that's great because of the wide diversity that's included there. Sarah, how about from your perspective? I know we've talked a little bit about Black North and that Accor has been involved in that. Can you maybe speak to what is appealing to Accor from that framework?
Sure. So the Black North initiative is really it was started by West Hall, Kingsdale Advisors, and then, you know, it's a initiative across corporate Canada, both public and private sectors. But it's really kind of Canadian companies, Canadian leaders for Canadians. And that, and I think that that really spoke to us. Wes wrote some significantly poignant, I thought, pieces in both the Globe articles that he wrote earlier, in 2020, and Toronto Star, with regards to, you know, even as a CEO of a fantastically successful business, what he experiences on a day-to-day basis living in, you know, the Tony neighborhood of Rosedale in Toronto. And this initiative, similar to what Dawn is speaking about with the federal government and 5030, I mean, I think what really attracts us to it is A, it's a pledge with quantitative targets, specific deadlines, but also it is a forum for sharing of what works and what doesn't work. And really the commitment to kind of making our workplaces a trusting place, having the conversations, driving awareness and education, making sure there are opportunities for employment for underrepresented groups, and how do we all work together to do that? And similar to 5030, it's not hospitality specific. I do think it would be great for the hospitality community, as Ritu talked about, to share ideas. But I also think what is powerful is for us to bring it in from other sources as well. And not reinvent the wheel if there is an opportunity to kind of share that information and learn from others. And again, both on what I like about Black North, very focused on what works and what doesn't work, because I think that sharing is often, we share the best practices, but we need to share the best done successful practices as well. So I think that. But I think the CEO pledge that we signed on to in July, I think that this is a movement across Canada that I think will have some real traction and is led by some fairly prominent Canadian leaders. And I think that we'll really deal with this in Canada's context, which I think is also important, that we're not, you know, as others have said on the call, we're not transporting, you know, different parts of the globe define diversity and inclusivity very differently because their reality is unique, and Canada's is unique as well, and making sure that we've got something that works in Canada, I think, is important.
That's a very good point. So thank you for sharing that. So if we were to take then those two frameworks, the Black North and the 5030 initiative, and build on it for something that is more specific to hospitality, taking the best practices that worked, obviously, and like Sarah said, some of the things that perhaps didn't work, to learn from those lessons. What more can we add that really reflects the hospitality world that we're all part of? So if maybe we can go around the table, so to speak, and get two or three points that are part of your wish list to see included in hospitality, so that it gives us a great starting point when we sit down to formulate what needs to be done moving forward. So Michelle, maybe from your end, what are two or three things that you like to see be part of this framework?
Thank you. I'll try to keep it to two and three. You know, I'm part of both worlds, hospitality and education. So I'm going to go back and really stick with hospitality as your question. I, and this is my perspective and my wish list, is seeing more Black faces, is seeing that when we have more hospitality webinars, it's easy for a moderator to reach out to a Black executive, a Black chef, a Black manager, a Black vice president, a Black CEO. And unfortunately, it's not right there. And I don't, accept the excuse of there isn't the Black talent. There is, we just have to be a little bit more creative in finding that Black talent. So I think there's opportunity to have more Black voices, Black leadership in hospitality, restaurants, hotels, event spaces, tourism, because they're on the front line and they're in the kitchen and they're in housekeeping. So a commitment to the management and training programs, to recruitment, to even race-based data, which I know can be tricky and controversial, but it's now is the time to just to go forward and say we need and where can we go. Communities, post-secondary education, secondary education, and then to your point, Roseanne, in partnering with already established initiatives like Black North, there's a Black Business and Professional Associations. There's a Canadian Association of Urban Financial Professionals. It is not just that hospitality program. It's going out and working with some of these associations that are actually already have their membership of Black leaders. Whether it's in finance, whether it's in athletics, you know, I don't see any reason why a financial manager couldn't find a great home at a core, or why a great Black leader who's been a great coach couldn't be a front of a house manager. So maybe it's going out of our comfort zone when it comes to recruiting Black leaders. I think there's also an opportunity as organizations take a look internally of what they're doing is make sure my recommendation is to include your Black employees. Include your Black employees who are when you're putting together these initiatives. You know, sometimes a Black or an Asian or a brown employee doesn't feel comfortable sitting in that unconscious bias if they're the only one and someone's up there moderating and talking about unconscious bias. So I would say get that feedback from your current Black employment group and see if they want to be part of the solution. Some don't. Not every Black individual is as militant as our family members. I grew up in a family that had very militant members and I was in my own little happy little bubble. So make sure that those that are working with you want to be part of the solution. And then of course, something that I was concerned of growing up is tokenism. I was concerned when I was the only manager, when I was the only trainer at a new restaurant opening. But now I think there's a time to push the envelope when it comes to tokenism. If there's only one Black executive, great, but be authentic. You know, that they're there for a reason and they're also part of the committees and part of the recruitment process. So there is a concern about that tokenism, but you know, we're at the point where maybe we do need that face. We do need that smiling face on that recruitment poster. We do need that one Black cashier that all of a sudden is on the training team. Then train them to be a great trainer, whatever we have to do. If we're afraid of tokenism, then it may hold us back, but move forward. So there's a lot that can be done. Hospitality has a loud voice, especially now. People are appreciating what hotels and travel and dining in a great restaurant mean in their life because they're missing it right now. Mm-hmm. So we have the opportunity to be a leader in this area and we have the workforce. We just need to make that commitment, the training, the recruitment, the development, and trying not to be afraid to say and do the wrong thing because then that'll just keep us from moving forward.
That's a very good wish list and some very well-stated points, Michelle. So thank you so much for that. Christina, from your perspective, when you look at that wish list, what does it look like?
There's a couple things. I mean, I think probably because of the time we're in right now, we haven't really discussed this, but I think we can't really leave out our guests and how guests also factor into conversations around racism, both in terms of how our own staff have created systems and how our guests feel comfortable, and also looking at who is being attracted to your places. I know that manifests a bit differently if you're a hotel versus a restaurant, but generally speaking, groups that are used to experiencing more discrimination also in turn become much more loyal. So in terms of which associations are choosing your groups would probably, especially if you're a hotel group, when conferences and everything start going again, or what your frequent visitors look like or your regulars, that really speaks to what the situation in terms of equality or in terms of comfort in your space looks like. It's having Black or people of color or queer employees. It doesn't necessarily ensure that your place isn't racist because they can still be operating in a system that is catered towards white comfort. So I think if you think about say very racist places in the South in the 60s, you'd be served by a Black person. So just the mere presence of them is not necessarily a guard against your whole system in your workplace still not still being something that is grounded in either white comfort or racism. And I think that's just something that helps everyone to understand, like you can have a group, but maybe even in meetings and structures, they're not allowed to make it what would be more inclusive overall. And I think beyond that, if everyone can challenge ourselves, I think with, I guess how for many people, events in May and June of 2020 was a big wake up call for your companies. And I think what is helpful is to do what we should be doing in our normal hospitality companies, which is getting out of being in a reactive mode towards complaints. So rather than only working from this is the problem that has been isolated, is looking at how have I structured everything to make sure that I'm also seeing eventually issues that maybe have not been called forth yet, but are general issues. And that's the same, like say if you're having issues with how food's getting run out of the kitchen, and you have to realize that maybe you have to redesign your floor plan. So you're just looking at that rather than just say firing your busser or getting new bussers. It's also worthwhile to think that maybe what you will get from your employees will be something that is maybe the biggest issues in their mind, but do not get to the heart of what the issue is in your company. And even something as simple as I was a former employee of a pretty big company, and they had the HR director that many of us had cited in our exit interviews for having racist and racist adjacent policies reach out to us and ask if we would fill out a survey for free that would go to their new consulting company that they got to help them on race issues. That wasn't exactly the smartest move to send to the people who was specifically named that person and other people in your HR for how they were treated, to then ask them to rehash it when you probably just had the exit interviews, assuming that you had filed them. So I think that's also worthwhile to think of who is doing these. And maybe that's why some of the feedback you might get, and this isn't for like people on the panel, this is in general, some of the feedback you might get, depending on how you're structuring these things, might not be as genuine, or they might be the things that they think you are capable of handling. So that's why maybe some of the feedback, I would especially listen to people who are giving feedback that's a little bit harder to hear, kind of like that kitchen nightmares thing, right? Like I would lean into the people who are giving the feedback that you're a little bit more defensive about, because that's probably the growth curve that honestly your employee that just wants to have a job after COVID might not want to take on, and might not want to add those dynamics to their already stressful life. And then I guess my last really quick one is that I think if you think of racism or sexism or any kind of discrimination as a violence, even if it's something that is a microaggression or small, then it makes it easier for you to think about everything as centering safety for your employees, your guests, or even yourself. So if you just rethink it as not just like an inconvenience, but actually a violence that can, even if it sounds dramatic, that can really help when you're analyzing your policies.
That's a really great point. Never looked at it like that. So thank you for sharing that, Christina. Dawn, how about from your perspective? Have you got a couple of wishes on that list?
Yeah, I mean, there's so many things we can do in this space, but I think the one I'll focus on right now is leaning in more on the recruitment, development, and promotion of people of color and our Black associates, right? It's sort of following up on Michelle's theme. I think a lot of companies are committed to diversity, but oftentimes use the excuse, well, there just aren't enough qualified candidates out there for us to hire them. And the reality is we've just got to start taking chances on people and putting them in those positions. I know for myself, and I think many people have experiences in their own careers where somebody took a chance on you and gave you a job that at the time you didn't think you were at all qualified for. And that's how you were able to move. And we need to do that more. And then we also need to begin to get more creative and partner with more groups and get more creative in traditional sources of going to get candidates that are people of color. So I think there's a lot more than we have historically done in this space. And that's an area where I think we can lean in. I'll give you one more example that we're doing in Canada. And we have this Emerging Leader Program, which is a program that's been around for a number of years. We take our high potential people that are at the senior manager and above, people that are ready to become GMs or ready to become VPs. And we've always had a desire to get more women into that program, but we are pivoting in that program and restarting it. It was put on hold last year because of COVID. We've made the decision that even though occupancies are still low, we have to restart that program this year. And we are relaunching it. And secondly, we're pivoting to make sure we get more people of color into that. And so it's things in the recruiting and development and promotion that I think is our biggest opportunity.
Wonderful. Juanita, from your perspective, I know you've already probably incorporated some of your wishes on your framework at Gusto, but any additional ones you can share with us?
Yeah, you know, the one I would add to this is really broadening the reach on the conversations that we're having, not only as a company, but as an industry as a whole. And I think in this particular case, we're stronger as a pack. We're relatively, you know, a small to medium sized company, and we're doing a lot of great things, but we're having the conversation with hundreds of people, right? If we extend that and really broaden our reach as an industry, and so as an industry, we're now having that conversation with hundreds of thousands of people, we're really going to make a difference. And one of my key takeaways with all of the research that we did within our company is that, and coming from a leader thinking we were doing all of the right things, my biggest takeaway is that people were suffering in silence and they weren't comfortable in having that conversation, because that conversation and these tough conversations were not normalized. They felt like they were not going to be accepted if they actually came out and said, I did not feel comfortable. Mm-hmm. And I, as a leader, want to create this environment and culture to say, no, we have to have this conversation. And the only way to normalize this is to have them frequently and often, and make it, take away the stigma to say, you know, every Thursday we're going to hear Ritu's story. Now we're going to hear Michelle's story. Now we're going to hear Angela's story. Like, let's really have this discussion to say, how can we actually change as individuals and not have the discussions behind closed doors, have them in an open forum, and leverage all of the amazing content that, you know, the bigger companies like Sarah's and Dawn's and even Gusto are. There's content and information out there. Let's broaden the reach and have this discussion with hundreds of thousands of people, not just our handful of employees.
Wonderful, wonderful points. Thank you. And Ritu, I'm going to give you the last word on your wish list as we wrap up the hour, which hard to believe it's already gone by, but what's your wish list?
Sure, absolutely. So Rosetta, you and I had discussed putting together sort of a framework for the industry. So as everyone today shared their stories and as everyone today shared their practices, I sort of put together a list of best practices. One thing that Michelle said that rang so true, because I was on a panel earlier this week and someone made a comment of they wanted to have more diversity, but it didn't exist in their network. And they were convinced that diversity did not exist. That annoyed the hell out of me, I'm sorry, because it does exist. You're just not looking in the right places. So I love what Michelle was saying with Black mentorship. We definitely need to do more of that. What Christina said about looking at this as a violence, however small it may be, or microaggressions, we definitely should put that message out there. Dawn spoke to hiring, promoting, reflecting diversity, unbiased training. These are all things that I believe that Rosanna, we can put into our framework that we can then send out so people have that mm-hmm. shared best practices. So those are, I mean, there was so much knowledge shared today, but those would be my top three for sure.
All right, well, that's great. And I think, you know, maybe the time, it's all about timing, as people say. And I think realistically, the last year, the industry has gone through such upheaval with the pandemic. And there's been so much discussion that the industry is broken and fractured and really needs to be put, you know, back together again. And I think this is the right time for us to do this, you know, because there is a lot of, you know, there is some truth to, obviously, the industry is broken in various ways. So I'm looking forward to, you know, being part of a group that maybe we can have some impact, some positive impact in fixing the industry back up, so that by the time this pandemic is over, we've got some really strong foundations. So I really wanted to thank everybody for sharing your insights on that. We do have a couple of questions and then we'll wrap up. So one of the questions, I guess, is directed to Michelle. And Michelle, you mentioned earlier today, and just bear with me while I get to this question. You mentioned earlier in our discussion that it's important to include Black employees in committees, but how do you encourage them to join when sometimes these committees are often steered by white executives?
That's a great question. And I was in that position that I didn't always want to join a committee because of that. There's two things. One, it has to do with a personal comfort level and where they are in their career, in their life, what's happening around them, because that was my situation. And then, and I, again, being very cautious of the tokenism, find a Black leader in your industry, your organization, and have that conversation. You know, every now and then when I'm not sure if I want to participate, I speak to my Black girls, my other Black chairs or Black director, and say, what do you think about this? I felt really uncomfortable. My personal examples, I felt uncomfortable being this Indigenous committee that we're in training, because every time they brought up something that the atrocities that were happening in our Indigenous brothers and sisters, I start taking it, well, what about us and what about us? So as Black leaders in this Indigenous training, we got together and shared our own experiences and were able to encourage each other to still participate and to see it as a way of being an ally and a sisterhood of working together with our Indigenous colleagues. So for me, it was reaching out. And unfortunately, if you are that only brown face, if you're that only Chinese employee in that division, and now you have to go to sensitivity training, I think it's okay to opt out. I think it's okay to say, I'm not feeling comfortable in this space, right? I appreciate what have you. And I think as organization, we have to accept that and say, well, I thought for sure you'd want to be there. We're doing it for you. And some people think that that's what they're actually doing. And then it causes more harm than good. So yes, sometimes you may opt not to be a part of that Black mentorship initiative because you don't feel comfortable. And that's okay. It takes time, especially as Juanita says, to normalize having these conversations. Right? I think it's funny and interesting and scary that, you know, my mom was very militant in the 60s and 70s and would tell me all these stories. I'm like, how do you even have those conversations? And yet we're still having the same conversations. And I'm remembering of how she encouraged me to say, no, speak your voice, you know, and thank for that. But I wasn't doing that in my 20s. I wasn't doing that when I was a front of the house manager. I wasn't doing that when I was trying to show my GM that I was really great. I was just focusing on being a great manager. But now I have the opportunity. Now I have the microphone. And now I'm going to do as much as I can to reach back and encourage those around me.
Wonderful. Well, thank you for that answer. And the last question, because we don't really have much more time, this is directed to anybody on the panel that wants to answer it. But in the last webinar, marketing and social media was mentioned as a place for improvement and that racialized groups should see themselves in a company's branding. Have any of today's panelists made changes to their marketing to address this?
Absolutely. So way back actually on more so on the residential side, whenever they would put together marketing plans for our own residential buildings, they didn't have anybody that was diverse. So we changed that immediately, and going forward for years, anytime you put out something that's an Ethan's or Gupta Group or any of our companies, I always make sure that there's diversity. So anybody that looks at it will feel like they can relate to it.
Wonderful. Anybody else want to tackle that?
I know that we're doing a bunch of rollouts for our, I guess we have two concepts. We have a almost ghost kitchen and we have our bar and Shopify. We are consciously, I mean, it's a little bit easier, but we are consciously always trying to have different, so we're doing family meal rollouts, consciously choosing different styles of families, not just like different colors, but also different structures, just to make sure that as we're creating something, we're making those opportunities that people can see someone who looks like them or someone who looks like their friends. And also coming at it from the perspective that like people are like, I think it's fair for us to assume that people are in community with each other. And sometimes these conversations where we call people allies assumes that there's someone from the outside that is coming to the rescue of people with other, like, to other people rather than people who are in community with each other. I think it's always helpful for us to think of it not so much that we are trying to get to this other community, but perhaps these people, like I have friends that are every kind of person. It is not hard for me to think of seeing different kinds of people. I do not feel excluded when I see white people, but I also do feel excluded if it's only white people on something, just like I don't feel excluded if I see a gay couple and I'm straight. So I think having that mentality that is not about this like straight marketing, like we're going to hit these different things, but theoretically you have people who are your guests and your staff who just, that is their life. Their life is being in community with very many people, and that should be your business. Should be in community with very many people as well.
Very well said. Well, thank you for that. As I mentioned, our time has run out, unfortunately, so we do need to wrap up today's discussion. Thank you to all of our committee members for taking time out of their busy schedules to provide input, constructive criticism, and direction and guidance. It's very, very appreciated. We have committed to a large undertaking here, but we are committed to seeing this through, to putting actions into place, to share resources, and really to be accountable for change. So we're committed to creating an industry that really helps deliver exceptional service to customers, but is also welcoming and discrimination-free for its staff. So thank you to all our viewers today who tuned in to be part of the discussion. And if anybody out there wants to be part of providing feedback, please feel free to reach out. We'd love to hear from you. A big thank you to Ritu Gupta, President and CEO of Easton's Hotels, for being a partner on this initiative and a great sponsor and supporter. So thank you for all that you do. We don't expect to eradicate racism overnight. That would be very naive, but we are committed to working hard and doing the necessary work to move this through. So above all, we really need to commit to working together as a group. And I think that that will help us on this journey to eradicate racism. So thank you for all your time and effort, and thank you for being here today. And that's it. That's all. Thanks so much and stay safe.
Thank you for the platform, Rosanna.
Very welcome.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Fellow participants, take care.
All right.
Have a great day.
Thanks again.